of the atheist, they consider science as the yardstick. They are so much impressed with science and technology that they only believe if it is proved by science or if it's proved by logic. Normal human logic will believe in a creator, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But these atheists, they want a scientific proof. Prove to me scientifically the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of Almighty God. And inshallah, in the next part of my speech, I'll be proving scientifically that the glorious Quran is the word of God, simultaneously proving the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'll ask this question to an atheist. I will ask the atheist that suppose there is an equipment who no one in the world has ever seen before, no one has heard of it before, and if that equipment is bought in front of you, who will be the first person who will be able to tell you the mechanism of this equipment? I would like to ask you, if some people are atheists in the audience, or if you are a believer in God, if you are asked, if I ask the atheist, that who will be the first person who will be able to tell you the mechanism of an equipment who no one in the world has heard of, no one has seen it before, who will be the first person who will be able to tell you the mechanism? Who's the first person? The creator. Someone said manufacturer. The producer. One is saying creator, manufacturer, producer. Some will say inventor. Whatever it is somewhat similar. The first person who will be able to tell you the mechanism of an equipment who no one in the world has seen before is the creator, it is the manufacturer, or the inventor, or the producer. Then I will ask the atheist that how did our universe come into existence? So he will tell me that the scientists, they tell us that our universe was initially a primary nebula. Later on, there was a secondary separation, a Big Bang, which gave rise to galaxies, which gave rise to stars, to planets, sun, moon, and the earth on which we live. This they call as the Big Bang. So I asked them, that when did you come to know about this Big Bang? So the atheist will tell me, it was in 1970s that a couple of scientists described the creation of the universe and called it the Big Bang, and they got the Nobel Prize for that. So I will tell him that what you told me about the Big Bang, the creation of the universe, is already mentioned in my Quran 1400 years ago in Surah Anbiya, chapter number 21, verse number 30, where it says, "Awalam yara lazina kafaru." Do not the unbelievers see? Anna samawati wal arda kana zatkan fataknahuma. That the heavens and the earth were joined together and we clove them asunder. This Big Bang, what you came to know recently, 45, 50 years back, is already mentioned in my Quran 1400 years ago. Who could have mentioned that in the Quran? So the atheist may say, maybe it came by fluke. I said, yes, possible. Can be something can come by fluke. I'll not argue. Then I ask him next question. That what is the shape of the earth on which we live? So the atheist will tell me that previously we thought, the human beings, that the earth was flat. It is recently we came to know in 1577, when Sir Francis Drake sailed around the earth, he proved that the earth was spherical. What you came to know in 1577, that's about 450 years back, is mentioned in my Quran 1400 years ago. It's mentioned in the Quran in Surah Luqman, chapter number 31, verse number 29. Alam tara anna Allah. Alam tara anna Allah yuliju layla fi nahari, yuliju nahara fi layl. That it is Allah who merges the night into the day and merges the day into the night. Merging is a gradual and slow process. It says that the night slowly and gradually merges into the day, and the day slowly and gradually merges into the night. This slow and gradual process of night changing to day and day changing to night is only possible if the shape of the earth is spherical. If the shape of the earth was flat, there would have been a sudden change. It's further mentioned in the Quran in Surah Az-Zumur, chapter number 39, verse number 5, that it is He who coils the night unto the day and coils or overlaps the day unto the night. The Arabic word used here is kawara, like how a person coils a turban around the head. This is only possible if the shape of the earth was spherical. It's not possible if it was flat. Furthermore, it's mentioned in the Quran. It's mentioned in Naziat, chapter number 79, verse number 30. Wal ard ba'da zalika dahaha. And thereafter, we have made the earth as an expanse. Dahaha, one of its meaning is expanse, and the other meaning is derived from the Arabic word duya, which means egg-shaped. Dahaha also means egg-shaped. Duya in Arabic means egg, and dahaha means egg-shaped. And we know today, the earth on which we live is not completely round like a ball. It is flattened from the pole. And we know that the Arabic word dahaha doesn't refer to a normal egg. It specifically refers to the egg of an ostrich. It also refers to the place where the ostrich lays the egg. And if you analyze the shape of an egg of an ostrich, that too is geospherical in shape. Imagine 1400 years ago, the Quran specifically says that the shape of the earth is geospherical. It does not say spherical, it says geospherical. For the egg of an ostrich too is geospherical. Who could have mentioned in the Quran 1400 years ago that the shape of the earth is geospherical in shape? So the atheist may say that maybe your Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, was intelligent. Don't argue, you can continue. I'll ask him the third question. That the light of the moon, is it its own light or reflected light? So he will tell me that previously we thought that the light of the moon is its own light. Recently, 100 years back, 200 years back, 300 years back, 400 years back, we came to know that the light of the moon is not its own light. It is the reflected light of the moon. What you came to know recently, a few hundred years back, is mentioned in the Quran 1400 years ago. In Surah Furqan, chapter number 35, verse number 61, where it says that blessed is he who has placed the constellation in the sky and placed therein sun having its own light and moon having borrowed or reflected light. Whenever the Quran speaks about sun, the Arabic word for sun is shams. Its light is always described as siraj, vahaj, or diya, meaning a torch, a lamp, or a shining glory. And the word used for moon is kamar. Its light is always described as munir or noor, meaning borrowed light or a reflection of light. So Quran says the light of the moon is not its own light, it's borrowed or reflected light. And this message is repeated also in Surah Yunus, chapter number 10, verse number 5, and Surah Nuh, chapter number 71, verse number 16, that the light of the moon is not its own light, but the reflected or borrowed light. Who could have mentioned this in the Quran 1400 years ago, that the light of the moon is not its own light, it's a reflected light? I say, maybe your Prophet Muhammad was super intelligent, don't argue. I'll ask him the next question. That when I was in school, I passed my school, 10th standard, in 1982. I had learned that the sun and the moon, they revolved. But besides revolving, I had learned that the sun did not rotate about its own axis. In that context, it was stationary. So atheist will ask me, is this mentioned in the Quran? I said, no, this is what I learned in school. This was mentioned in my school book. But when I read the Quran says in Surah Anbiya, chapter number 21, verse number 33, هُوَ الَّذِي خَلَقَ اللَّيْلَ وَالنَّهَارَ. It's Allah who has created the night and the day. وَالشَّمْسَ وَالْقَمَرَ. The sun and the moon. كُلُّ فِيهِ يَسْبَحُونَ. Each one rotating in its own orbit. كُلُّ فِيهِ فَلَكِ يَسْبَحُونَ. Each one rotating about its own orbit. The Arabic word used here is يَسْبَحُونَ. Derived from the Arabic word sabaha, which describes the movement or motion of a moving body. For example, if I use this Arabic word for a person on the floor, it will not mean he's rolling, it will mean he's running or he's walking. If I use it for a person in water, it will not mean he's floating, it will mean he's swimming. If I use it for a celestial body in the sky, in the heaven, it will not mean it's flying, it will mean it is rotating about its own axis. So Quran says the sun and the moon, besides revolving, also rotate about their own axis. And today, after science advance, we have come to know that the sun rotates. We can have the object of the sun on a tabletop with the help of an equipment, and we find there are black spots. And these black spots take about 25 days to complete one rotation, indicating that the sun takes about 25 days to complete one rotation. And today, if you read the school books, most of the school books have incorporated, and they do agree that the sun rotates. Imagine when I was in school, I was taught the sun was stationary. Hardly about 40 years back, 50 years back, they came to know that the sun rotates about its own axis. But Quran says 1400 years ago that the sun, besides revolving, also rotates about its own axis, which we came to know recently. Who could have mentioned this in the Quran? When I was in school, I was taught it was stationary. It did not rotate about its axis. Who could have mentioned in this book 14 years ago that the sun rotates about its own axis? And there'll be a long pause. The atheist will not reply. Don't wait for the reply, continue. Today, science tells us that the atmosphere outside the earth, which we call in layman's terminology as sky, it prevents the harmful radiation, the X-rays and the ultraviolet rays, from outside to reach the earth. And because of this, life can sustain on this earth. If this was not there, if this atmosphere, this sky wasn't there, life could not exist on the face of the earth because of ultraviolet rays and the X-rays. Quran says in Surah Anbiya, chapter number 21, verse number 32, that we have made the sky as a protected ceiling. What we came to know recently, a few hundred years back, the Quran says 1400 years ago, that the sky we have made as a protected ceiling. Today, scientists, they tell us that the sunlight we have is due to a chemical reaction taking place since billions of years. And one day, this chemical reaction will stop and sun will cease to exist, but they say it will take another couple of billion years. Quran says in Surah Yasin, chapter number 36, verse number 38, وَالشَّمْسِ تَجْرِي لِمُسْتَقَرِ اللَّهَ. وَالشَّمْسُ تَجْرِي لِمُسْتَقَرِ اللَّهَ. That the sun is running its course for a period determined, to a place determined. Arabic word mustaqar means for a period determined. It means a place determined. Today, science tells us that the sun is moving to a point in the universe, in the Herculean, known as Alpha Lyra, to a spot which they call as the solar apex, at the speed of 12 miles per second. So Quran covers both in the word mustaqar, running to a place determined and running for a period determined, which science has come to know recently. Who could have mentioned this in the Quran 14 years ago? Don't wait for the reply, continue. When I was in school, I learned in school that there were three states of matter: solid, liquid and gas. And the scientists at that time, they thought that the space outside the organized astronomical systems, there was vacuum. Today, science has advanced and we have come to know that outside the organized astronomical system is not vacuum, they call it as plasma. And they call it the fourth state of matter. Quran says in Surah Furqan, chapter number 25, verse number 59, that it is He who has created heaven and the earth and everything in between it also. That means there is something in between. It's not vacuum as the scientists thought before. So what we came to know recently, just a few decades before, Quran mentions 14 years ago about the fourth state of matter, that is plasma. A very famous scientist by the name of Edwin Hubble, in the last century, he discovered that the universe is expanding, and which was considered as one of the biggest or best discovery in the last century. Quran says clearly in Surah Dariyat, chapter number 51, verse number 47, that we have created the vastness of space, the expanding universe. The Arabic word used here is Mosuna, meaning expanding universe. So Quran says 1400 years ago, which we came to know hardly 100 years back, that the universe is expanding. There may be certain skeptics of Islam who may say, it's nothing great that the Quran speaks about astronomy, since the Arabs were advanced in the field of astronomy. I agree with them that the Arabs were advanced in the field of astronomy, but I'd like to remind them, it was centuries after the Quran was revealed that the Arabs became advanced in the field of astronomy. So it's from the Quran the Arabs learned about astronomy and not the vice versa. In the field of physics, there was a very famous theory known as atomism, which was first propounded by the Democrats, the Greeks, 23 centuries before. And this theory, atomism, said that atom is the smallest part of matter which cannot be divided. And in Arabic, for the word atom, we use the word zarra. And Quran does say that speaks about zarra, the smallest part. But today, science has advanced, and we have come to know that even an atom can be subdivided into protons, into neutrons, into electrons. Though atom is the smallest part of matter, having the characteristics of its element, but yet it can be divided. So when Quran speaks about zarra, atom, being the smallest part, people will think that Quran is outdated. But the Quran says in Surah Sabah, chapter number 34, verse number 3, as well as Surah Yunus, chapter number 10, verse number 61, that when they ask, when the unbelievers ask, that how will the hour, when will the hour come? Tell them, it will surely come with the permission of thy Lord, in whose record is clear details as small as the atom. And in his record is propitious things smaller and greater than the atom. So the Quran says, in Allah's record is clear things smaller and greater than the atom, indicating that there are things smaller than the atom, which science has discovered recently. So what science came to know recently, 50 years back, 100 years back, 200 years back, 300 years back, Quran has mentioned 1400 years ago. Who could have mentioned this? In the field of hydrology, we learn in school, even I learned, and even you might have learned, about the water cycle. Sir Bernard Palissy was the first person who described the water cycle which we study in school. Sir Bernard Palissy in 1580 first described the water cycle. And we learned in school that the water evaporates from the ocean, forms into clouds, the clouds move into the interior, and the water falls, and the water table is replenished and the cycle is completed. Previously, in 7th century BC, Thales of Miletus, he said that it was the spray of the ocean which was picked up by the winds which fell into the interior as rain. People did not know from where did the underground water come. People thought from the time of Plato that it was the pressure of the winds on the oceans which led the water into the interiors and went back by secret passage known as Taurus. And this was believed till as late as 16th century, even by Descartes. Plus in the 17th century. He believed in it. They did not know where the underground water came from. Even Aristotle in the 19th century believed it was the caverns and caves which condensed the water which fed the springs beneath the ground. Today we come to know, and we have come to know that it is the seepage of the rainwater in the cracks in the ground which gives rise to the underground water and springs. Quran says in Surah Az-Zumar, chapter number 39, verse number 21, "Seest thou not, it is he who sends down water from the sky and leads it in cracks in the ground and causes sown field of varying colors to grow." Quran says in Surah Rum, chapter number 30, verse number 24, that it is he who sends down water from the sky and gives life to the earth after it is dead. It's mentioned in Surah Mu'minun, chapter number 23, verse number 18. It is he who sends down water from the sky and he is able to soak it, to store it, and is even able to drain it. Quran says in Surah Al-Hijr, chapter number 15, verse number 22, that we send fecundating winds. The Arabic word used is zawake, coming from the word lakaha, coming from lucky, which means to fecundate. Today science tells us that the rainwater we have is due to the pollen grains being pushed by the winds into the clouds. That's one reason. And the second is in the clouds joined together and they form into a heap and then water emerges from the clouds. So this the Quran described 1400 years ago, which we came to know recently, that he sends fecundating winds. He impregnates the cloud and then water falls from the sky. Quran says in Surah Hud, chapter number 24, verse number 43, that it is the clouds which join and gently become bigger and then water emerges from the top. What emerges from the sky? The Quran mentions Surah Rum, chapter number 30, verse number 48, that how does the water rise from the ocean, forms into clouds, the clouds join, the clouds move to the interior, and the water falls. The Quran speaks about the water cycle in great detail in several places. It's also mentioned Surah Araf, chapter number 7, verse 57. In Surah Rod, chapter number 13, verse number 17. It's mentioned Surah Furqan, chapter number 25, verse number 40 and 49. It's mentioned Surah Fatir, chapter number 35, verse number 9. In Surah Yasin, chapter number 36, verse number 34. It's mentioned in Surah Ghashiyah, chapter number 45, verse number 5. It's mentioned Surah Qaf, chapter number 50, verse number 9 and 10. It's mentioned Surah Waqiyah, chapter number 51, chapter number 56. Verse number 67 to 70. It's mentioned in Surah Mulk, chapter number 67, verse number 30. It's mentioned in Surah Tarikh, chapter number 86, verse number 11. I can keep on giving references only in the Quran which speak about the water cycle in great detail. What we learned in school, what was discovered in 1580 by Sir Bernard Palissy, is mentioned in great detail in several places in the Quran. Who could have mentioned this in the Quran 1400 years ago? In the field of geology, today the geologists they tell us that the earth in which we live, its radius is approximately 3,750 miles. And the deeper layer, they are fluid and they are hot. They cannot sustain life. And as it keeps on going on top, it gets into solid. And the superficial layer is a thin crust, about 1 to 30 miles in thickness. And there are high possibility that this superficial layer, the outer crust of the earth, this would shake. It is due to the folding phenomena, which gives rise to mountain ranges, which prevents the earth from shaking. Quran says in Surah Naba, chapter number 78, verse number 6 and 7, that we have made the earth as an expanse. Wal jibala autada, and the mountains as sticks. The Arabic word used here, autad, means tent pegs, meaning sticks. Tent peg is when we put the tent peg into the ground, the major portion goes into the ground and a small portion is above the ground. So the Quran says that we have made the mountains as tent pegs. The Quran further says, it's mentioned in Naziat, chapter number 79, verse number 32, and Surah Anbiya, chapter number 21, verse number 31, that we have placed on the earth mountains standing firm. Today, in all the universities and colleges which teach about geology, one of the basic textbooks is called as The Earth. And one of its authors is Dr. Frank Press, who was previously the president of the Academy of Sciences in USA and was also the science advisor to the ex-president of USA, Jimmy Carter. And he writes in the book, and he draws the diagram of the mountain and shows that the mountains has got roots, and he draws wedge shape deep within the ground. And he says one of the major functions of the mountain is stability of the earth, to prevent the earth from shaking. And this is exactly what the Quran says. Quran says Surah Anbiya, chapter number 21, verse number 31, and Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 15, that we have placed on the earth mountains standing firm, lest it would shake with you. So Quran describes the exact function of the mountain to prevent the earth from shaking 1400 years ago, which we came to know recently. In the field of oceanology, the Quran says in Surah Furqan, chapter number 25, verse number 53, that it is he who has let free two bodies of flowing water, one sweet and palatable and the other salty and bitter. Though they meet, they do not mix. There is a barrier which is forbidden to be trespassed. It's further mentioned in Surah Al-Rahman, chapter number 55, verse number 19 and 20. Marajal bahrain yaltaqiyan bainama barzakh la yabghiyan, that it is he who has let free two bodies of flowing water. Though they meet, they do not mix. There is a barrier which is forbidden to be trespassed. Previously, the commentators of the Quran, they did not understand what did the Quran mean by saying that there are two types of water, salty and sweet. Though they meet, they do not mix. We knew that there were two types of water, sweet and salty. But what did the Quran mean by saying they meet but do not mix? Today, after science advance, we have come to know that whenever one type of water flows into the other type of water, it loses its constituents and gets homogenized into the water it flows. This area, today science calls it as the homogenizing area, which the Quran refers to as barzakh, an unseen barrier. And this can be seen very clearly if you go to the southernmost tip of South Africa, at Cape Point or Cape of Good Hope. There you find that one water flows into the other, even the color of both the waters differ. And you can clearly, from your naked eye, see the difference in the color, as though there's a barrier between them. It can even be seen in Egypt, when River Nile flows into the Mediterranean Sea. And the best example is the Gulf of Mexico, which flows for thousands of miles. It starts from the Gulf of Mexico and goes later on eastwards. And if you travel in a boat through towards the Gulf Stream, and if you pick up water from one side and pick up water from the other side, you will find one is sweet and the other is salty. Even the temperature between the two differ. Imagine what we came to know recently. Quran mentioned 14 years ago. In the field of medicine, in the field of biology, Quran says in Surah Anbiya, chapter number 21, verse number 30, وَجَعَلْنَا مِنَ الْمَعَيْ كُلَّ شَيْنَ أَفْلَا يُمِنُونَ, that we have made every living creature from water. Will you not then believe? Imagine in the deserts of Arabia, the Quran mentions where there was scarcity of water, that every living creature is made from water. Who could have believed in it? Who would have believed in it? You can think of a thousand things. Who would have believed that every living creature is made of water where there's scarcity of water? Today, after science advances, we have come to know that every living creature, its basic unit is the cell. And the cell contains cytoplasm, which contains 80% water. And today, science tells us every living creature contains about 50 to 90% water. Quran says in Surah Nur, chapter number 24, verse 45, we have created every animal from water. Quran says in Surah Furqan, chapter 25, verse 54, we have created every human being from water. Who could have mentioned this in the Quran? There is something in mathematics known as theory of probability. Theory of probability means if you guess something, the chances it will be correct is 1 upon the number of options that is there. For example, if I toss a coin, it can either be heads or tails, two options. The chances that if I make a wild guess, the chances that I'll be right is 1 upon 2, it is 50%. This is called as theory of probability. If I toss the coin twice, the chances I'll be right both the times is 1 upon 2 multiplied by 1 upon 2. 50% of 50% becomes 1 upon 4 becomes 25%. If I toss the coin thrice, the chances I'll be right all three times is 1 upon 2 into 1 upon 2 into 1 upon 2. 50% of 50% of 50%, it is 1 upon 8. That is 12.5%. This is called as theory of probability. If I throw a dice has got six sides. It can either be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. If I make a wild guess, the chances I'll be correct is 1 upon 6. If I throw the dice twice, the chances I'll be right both the times is 1 upon 6. By 1 upon 6, it is 1 upon 36. This is called as theory of probability. Now, if some atheist says that what I'm talking about science and someone has guessed it, what is the probability of someone guessing it? Let us calculate. I had said earlier that the Quran mentioned the shape of the earth is spherical. What are the options? A person can think at least of minimum 10 shapes. The earth can be flat, the earth can be triangular, the earth can be square, the earth can be rectangle, the earth can be spherical. 10 options you can think of. The chances that someone makes a wild guess, he will be correct by 1 upon 10. I had mentioned in my talk that the light of the moon is its. It is not its own light, it's reflected light. It can either be its own light or reflected light, two options. The chances someone makes a wild guess, the light of the moon being reflected light being correct, is 1 upon 2. The chances that both the earth is spherical and the light of the moon is not its own light, reflected light, both being correct, is 1 upon 10 into 1 upon 2 is 1 upon 20, it is 5%. 100 guesses he'll make, or 20 guesses he'll make, the chance he'll be right is 1. We were just discussing that every living creature is made from water. If you have to think, what can the living creatures be made of in deserts? You would think of sand, you would think of brick, you would think of stone, you would think of wood. Water will come, man, I don't know, maybe after 1,000 guesses. So if there are 1,000 things that the living creature can be made of, the chances that you say water and it being correct is 1 upon 1,000. That is 0.1%. The chances that all three, the earth is spherical, the light of the moon is reflected light, and everything made from water is 1 upon 10 by 1 upon 2 by 1 upon 1,000 is equal to 5% of 0.1%, 0.005%. You can go home and calculate. So the chances that three things I have mentioned, anyone making a wild guess is 0.005%. I have mentioned so many scientific facts, and there are many more. Today mathematics tells us that anything raised to 50 zero, it becomes zero. Anything number raised to 50 zero, negative 50 zero on top, it is as good as zero. Now if you take all the options I mentioned, about sky protected ceiling, about so many things that I mentioned, about the sun rotating, all these things if you add, and many more which I'll be speaking, it will be multiple times much more than 50 zero, negative 50 zero. So in mathematics, according to the theory of probability, the chances that someone makes a guess and all these being correct is a zero. So no atheist who has knowledge of mathematics can ever tell you again, it's a guess. First time you can say, second time you can say, third time you can say, fourth time. And I'm aware that there are guesses made. There were some guesses made by some of the philosophers, which were 450 BC, which 6 BC, before the Quran. But these are guesses, which were proved later on. For someone, and the same person said 10 things, out of which 1 came right and 9 came wrong. So anyone to pick up the correct from all these philosophers also would be guesswork. And guesswork being right, according to maths, is zero. So some people say, yes, but it was known that the world was spherical. I said, yes, 6 BC. But that same person also said that the earth is the center of the universe. Is it correct? No. So he made 10 guesses, 1 came right. But someone to pick up all the correct guesses and many things which were not existing and say, the probability is zero. For him to pick up the 10 things scientists said, to pick up one right and leave the wrong, also is probability. So he put it to probability, he said 10 things, one is right, okay, 1 out of 10. The other scientist also said 100 things, 2 came right. What's the chance? 2%. You keep on adding. It is inhuman for all to come correct. It is not possible. The possibility and probability is zero. Quran speaks about botany. Quran says in Surah Taha, chapter number 20, verse number 53, that it is He that brings the water from the sky, and with it brings diverse pairs of plant, each separate from the other. The Quran says that even the plants have got sexes, male and female. The Arabic word used is azwaj, zawja, meaning pairs, male and female. Previously we knew that the human beings and animals have got sexes, male and female. We did not know that even plants have sexes, male and female. Like more recently, 200 years back, 300 years back, 400 years back. Who could have mentioned the Quran 40 years ago? Quran says in Surah Ra'd, chapter number 30, verse number 3, we have made every kind of fruit in pairs, male and female. The Quran says in Surah Yasin, chapter number 36, verse number 36, that we have made in pairs those things which the human beings know and those things which the human beings don't know. So Allah says in the Quran, He has made everything in pairs, even the things the human beings know and the things human beings don't know. Previously, we did not know the plants are male and female. We came know recently. We did not know that even electricity, which we came know recently, is in pairs, negative and positive. We discovered now. So Quran says everything is made in pair. Something we know of, something we don't know, maybe we'll know later on. In the field of zoology, Quran says in Surah An'am, chapter number 6, verse number 38, that it is He who has created every animal that walks on the earth and every bird that flies in the air to live in communities like the human being. The Quran says that the animals and the birds, they live in community like the human being. Today, science tells us that the animals and birds, they live in community, which the Quran mentioned 14 years ago. Quran says in Surah An-Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 68 and 69, that it is He who has taught the bees to build its cells in trees, in hills, in human habitations, and to find the spacious path of thy Lord with great skill. What does the Quran mean by saying He has taught the bee to find the spacious path of thy Lord with great skill? It was so fawn fresh. In 1973, who got the Nobel Prize for discovering the behavior of the bee. And he said that whenever a bee finds a new flower or a new garden, it goes and tells its fellow bee the exact direction of the new flower or the new garden with a process known as the bee dance. Imagine Quran talks about the behavior of the bee 14 years ago, which scientists discovered now and they get Nobel Prize for that. Hardly 45 years back. Quran even mentions the sex of the worker bee as female. It says fasluki akuli, meaning the female bee, which is a worker bee, the worker bee is a female bee. Previously, we thought that the worker bee was a male bee. That is the reason Shakespeare, in his play, Henry IV, he writes that the soldiers, the male bee, they work and they report to the king. Today, science tells us the worker bee is not the male bee, it is a female bee, and they don't report to the king, they report to the queen. Imagine Quran, 1400 years ago, even specifies the sex of the worker bee as being female. Quran says in Surah An-Kabut, chapter number 29, verse number 41, that as to those who take for protectors anyone besides Almighty God, they build for themselves houses like that of the spider. Verily, the house of the spider is flimsy. What does the Quran mean by saying that if anyone takes for a protector anyone besides Almighty God, he built for himself a house like that of the spider? Today we know that the house of the spider, the web, is flimsy. But besides that, today we have also come to know that about the family relationship in the family of a spider. Many a time, the female spider kills the male spider and is called as the black widow. So Quran, besides describing the physical nature of the spider as being fragile and delicate, it also talks about the relationship where many a times the female spider kills the male spider. Quran says in Surah An-Naml, chapter number 27, verse number 17 and 18, that when Solomon, when he marched with his host of men, jinns and birds, and when they approached a lowly valley of ants, one of the ants said, "O ye ants, get into your habitations, lest Solomon and his army unknowingly will trample us beneath the feet." Some people may say, what kind of a fairy tale book is the Quran? The ants, they're talking among themselves. This happens in fairy tale books. Today, science tells us that the animal or any insect which has the closest resemblance to the lifestyle of the human beings, it is the ant. The ant buries their dead the same way the human beings do. The ants have a sophisticated method of labor, where their managers, foremen, supervisors, worker, they have a very sophisticated method of communication. They very often meet to chat. They even have marketplaces where they exchange goods. You know, sukh, marketplace. They have marketplaces where they exchange goods. And if the grain they are storing If it buds, they chop off the bud as though they knew that budding will cause rotting of the grain. And if in the rainy season, if they store the grain and the grain gets wet, they bring it out in the sunlight to dry as though they knew that humidity will cause rotting of the grain. You know, when I was a kid, many a time I used to see these ants taking the grain in the sunlight. I used to wonder where they are going. Now I have come to know the ants take the grain in the sunlight to dry as though they knew that humidity will cause the rotting of the grain. In the field of medicine, the Quran says in Surah An'am, chapter number 16, verse number 68-69, that from the belly of the bee, we give you a drink of varying colors in which there is healing for humankind. Previously, we did not know that honey was obtained from the belly of the bees. This we came to know about 300 years back. And today, science tells us that the honey is rich in vitamin K and fructose. Today, science also tells us that honey has got mild antiseptic properties. No wonder the Russian soldiers in World War II, they used honey to cover up their wound. Healing was done with leaving very little scar tissue. And because of the density of honey, germs and bacteria was prevented to grow in the wound. And if a person is suffering from allergy of a particular plant, if honey obtained from that plant is given to that person, he starts developing resistance to that allergy. In the field of physiology, the Quran mentions 14 years ago regarding blood circulation and the production of milk. 600 years after the Quran was revealed, Ibn Nafis, a very famous Muslim scientist, he first discovered the blood circulation. And 400 years after Ibn Nafis, William Harvey made it famous to the Western world. In our science textbook today, we read about William Harvey, we don't read about Ibn Nafis. Why? Because he's a Muslim. We know about William Harvey, but not about Ibn Nafis. William Harvey told to the Western world 1,000 years after the Quran was revealed. I'll just tell you in a nutshell. Today science tells us that the food we eat, it goes into the stomach. From the stomach, it goes into the intestine. From the intestine, via the blood vessels of the intestine, the food constituents goes into the bloodstream and goes to all the various organs of the body, many a times by complex media, the liver. It even goes to the mammary glands, which is responsible for the production of milk. This is, in short, blood circulation and production of milk. And this is exactly what is mentioned in the Quran 1400 years ago in Surah An-Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 66, where it says that verily in the cattle there is a lesson for you. We give you to drink from what is within the body, coming from a conjunction of the constituent of the intestine and blood, milk which is pure for you to drink. A similar message is repeated. It's mentioned in Surah Mu'minun, chapter number 23, verse number 21, that verily in the cattle is a sign for you. We give you to drink from what is within the body, coming from conjunction of blood and the constituent of intestine, milk which is pure for you to have. And in it are various benefits. And you derive warmth from them. And of the meat you can eat. So Quran speaks about the blood circulation and the production of milk in a nutshell 1400 years ago. In the subject of embryology, about 35-40 years back, there were a group of Arab students who collected all the data given in the Quran and in the Sahih Hadith about embryology and presented to Keith Moore. They followed the guidance of the Quran in Surah Anbiya, chapter 21, verse 7, and Surah Nahl, chapter 16, verse 43, which says, Fas'alu ahli zikri in kuntum la ta'lamu. If you don't know, ask the person who is knowledgeable, who possesses knowledge. So they took the matter dealing with embryology to the person who had the maximum knowledge of embryology in the world. He can be a non-Muslim, no problem. So they presented the translation of the Quran and the Hadith dealing with embryology to Professor Keith Moore in the late part of the 70s and the early part of the 1980s. late part of 1970s and early part of 1980s. And Professor Keith Moore at that time was the head of the Department of Anatomy in the University of Toronto in Canada. And he was the authority of embryology that time. When he was presented with all these verses of the Quran, the translation, he said that most of the things what the Quran speaks about embryology, most of it is correct. I refer, brother, can you just leave the stage? I'm spoiling the recording. Most of the thing that is mentioned in the Quran regarding embryology is correct, but something I cannot say that it is right, neither can I say it is wrong, because I myself do not know about it. And one such thing is regarding the first verse of the Quran to be revealed, that is for Iqra, that is for Allah. Chapter 96, verse 1 to 2, which says, Ikram bismi rabbika allazi khalaq, khalaqal insana min alaq. Read, recite, and proclaim in the name of the Lord who created the human beings from something which clings a leech-like substance. So Professor Keith Moore said, I do not know whether the embryo in the early stages looks like a leech or not. So he went into his laboratory, and under a very powerful microscope, he observed the early stages of embryo and compared it with a photograph of a leech, and he was astonished at the striking resemblance. And later on, when about 80 questions were asked to him regarding embryology, at that time, in the late 1970s, he said that embryology is a new branch of medicine which has developed recently. If you have asked me these questions 30 years back, I would not be able to answer more than 50%. And later on, whatever new knowledge he got from the Quran and the Sahih Hadith, he incorporated it into his book, The Developing Human Being, which got an award in 1982 for the best medical book written by a single author. And that book, even we referred when we were in medical college, when I did my first year MBBS. You know, if you want to just pass an embryology, we referred to Inder Bir Singh. You know, that's an Indian author. But if you wanted to score marks, we had to refer to the book, The Developing Human Being, by Professor Keith Moore. So we studied this book. And he said that I have got no objection in agreeing that Quran is God's word and Prophet Muhammad is the messenger of God. It's mentioned, Surah Tariq, chapter number 86, verse number 5 to 6. That does not man think from what he's created? He's created from a drop emitted from a space between the backbone and the ribs. What does the Quran mean by saying human beings are created from a drop emitted from a space between the backbone and the ribs? Today, science tells us that the genital organs in the human beings, the testicles in male and the ovaries in the females, they originate from a space close to the kidney, between the backbone and the 11th and 12th rib. Later on, they descend in the embryonic age, and the descent in the female, the ovary descend to the true pelvis, and in the male, via the inguinal canal, the testicle descend to the scrotum. But yet, even after the descent, in the adult life, they receive the blood supply and the nerve supply from the same space between the backbone and the ribs. They get the blood supply from the aorta, and the venous return goes back to the same space between the backbone and the 11th and 12th rib. The Quran says in Surah Mu'minun, chapter number 23, verse number 13, and in Surah Hajj, chapter 22, verse number 5, that we have created this human being from nutfa. Nutfa means a minute quantity of liquid, a small trickle of liquid. Today, science tells us that out of the 300 million sperms that are normally ejaculated in a male, only one sperm is sufficient to fertilize the ovum. This is a minute quantity, nutfa. Quran says in Surah Sajda, chapter 32, verse number 8, that we have created the human being from sulala. Sulala means the best part of the whole. One sperm out of 300 million sperm, the Quran refers to as sulala, the best part of the whole. Only one sperm is sufficient to fertilize the ovum. Quran says this for Insan, chapter number 76, verse number 2. We have created the human beings from a minute quantity of mingled fluids. For a human being to be born, the fluids of the female, the male, the seminal vesicles, all are required. In the field of genetics, we have come to know recently that the human beings are a male. Today, science tells us it is the male which is responsible for deciphering the sex of the child. If the X of the male takes part in the fertilization, then a female is born. If the Y of the male takes part in the fertilization, a male is born. This is exactly what the Quran says 14 years ago. It's mentioned in Najm, chapter number 53, verse number 45 and 46, that we have created the human beings from a minute quantity of liquid gushing forth from a male and made into sex, male and female. The Arabic word used is tumna, coming forth from a male. That means the sperm is responsible for deciphering the sex of the child, male or female. Quran repeats a similar message in Surah Insan, chapter number 75, verse number 37 to 39, that we have created the human being from a minute quantity of sperm. Nutfatin mani yumna. Nutfatin mani yumna means a minute quantity of sperm, then made into an alaka, then made into a mudga, then gave it sex, male or female. The Quran says that a minute quantity of sperm is responsible for the sex of the child. The country where I come from, India, for reasons best known to them, Indians normally prefer having sons rather than daughters. And it's very often that if a lady gives birth to a daughter, then the mother-in-law will blame the daughter-in-law that why did you give birth to a daughter? According to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and according to science, it is the male fluid which is responsible for giving the sex of the child and not the female. It is Allah, but through the male. So if the mother has to blame anyone, she should not blame the daughter-in-law, she should blame the son. Because Allah says and science says, it is the male which is responsible for deciding the sex of the child. Furthermore, it's mentioned in Surah Azab, chapter number 39, verse number 8. The organizers are telling me that, you know, we have shortage of time. It is mentioned, no, you have and I have, but the auditorium doesn't have. We have to follow the rules and regulation. No, because the auditorium could not be got on time, it was booked, but alhamdulillah. Inshallah, we'll try and end it 5-10 minutes before 10 o'clock. 10 o'clock is the time we have to leave. We have to be out, so inshallah, we'll try and end it by quarter, inshallah. And normally I give a longer time for... Quran says, in Surah Insan, chapter number 76, verse number 2, we have given the human beings the faculty of hearing and sight. The Quran says, we have given the human beings the faculty of hearing and sight. Hearing and sight. Today science tells us the first sense to develop in the human being is the sense of hearing by the 5th month of pregnancy. And later on comes the sense of sight and the eye opens up. Quran says in Surah Mu'minun chapter number 23, verse number 12 to 14, it speaks about the various embryological stages in great detail. Quran says that we have created the human being from a minute quantity of liquid, then made it into an alaka and placed it into a qarar-e maqim, a place of security, then made the alaka into a mudga, a chewed like lump, then made the mudga into izama bones, then clothed the izama bones with flesh. Glory be to Allah, who's the best to create. Then we created a new creature. Glory be to Allah, the best to create. These three verses of the Quran speaks about the embryological stages in great detail. We created the human being from a minute quantity of liquid, which we discussed, then placed it into a qarar-e-makin, a place of security. And we know today science tells us that the embryo is protected posteriorly by the backbone and the posterior muscles, and anterior by the anti-abdominal wall, and the endocrinic membrane. It says we made into alaka, a leech-like substance. Alaka has got three meanings. One of the meaning is leech-like substance, which we discuss. It also means something which clings, and we know that the embryo clings to the uterine wall. And the third meaning is that it is a congealed clot of blood. And today science tells us, at this stage of the embryo, the blood does not circulate, and the embryo looks like a congealed clot of blood. So all three meanings, alhamdulillah, correct of alaka. Something which clings, a leech-like substance, and a congealed clot of blood. Further it says, we made into a mudga. Mudga means a chewed-like lump. So Professor Keith took a plaster seal and made it look into the early stage of embryo and bit it between his teeth to make it resemble a chewed-like lump, mudga. And he was shocked that the teeth mark, they resemble the somites from where the nerves develop. We made the mudga into isama bones, then clothed the bones with flesh. Then he created a new creature. What does Quran mean by saying he created a new creature? Today science tells us, until this stage, the stages of development in the embryo of the other animals like rabbit and fish is the same. Only after this, the human development changes, where a human being has got head, has got hands, has got feet. Then Allah says, we have made a new creature. Glory be to Allah, who is the best to create. Quran says in Surah Hajj, chapter 22, verse number 5, that we have created the human being from an alaka and made into a mudga, partly formed and partly unformed. What does the Quran mean by saying partly formed and partly unformed? If we do an incision at this particular stage of the embryo, we come to know that some of the organs are formed, some are not formed. Some cells are differentiated, some are not differentiated. When Sir Marshall Johnson, that of gynecology, when he was showed this, he said there is no better description than the description of the Quran. At this stage, the embryo is partly formed and partly unformed, because some organs are complete, some are incomplete, some cells are differentiated, some are undifferentiated. Due to shortage of time, I'll just mention two more scientific facts before I end my talk. Quran says in Surah Qiyamah, chapter 75, verse number 3 and 4, that when the unbelievers say that how will Almighty God be able to reconstruct the bones after the human beings have been buried, the bones have got rotten, how will he be able to reconstruct the bones? So Allah tells them, Quran says, tell them, not only can he reconstruct the bones, he can reconstruct in perfect order the very tips of the finger. What does the Quran mean by saying Almighty God can not only reconstruct the bone, he can reconstruct in perfect order the very tips of the finger? It was in 1880 that Sir Francis Gold discovered the fingerprinting method. And he said that no two fingerprints, even in a million human beings, are identical. And today this fingerprinting method is used by the police, by the FBI, by the CIA, by the CID. What we came to in 1880, hardly 135 years back, the Quran mentions 1400 years ago about the fingerprinting method. I would like to mention a last scientific fact. Dr. Professor Thakurthakashan hails from Thailand, and he spent a great deal of time in doing research on pain receptors. Previously, we doctors thought that only the brain was responsible for the feeling of pain. Now we have come to know there are certain receptors in the pain which are also responsible for feeling of pain. That is the reason when a patient of burn injury comes, the doctor takes a pin and pricks it in the area of burn. If the patient feels pain, doctor is happy. It's a superficial burn. If the patient does not feel pain, the doctor is sad. It's a deep burn. Quran says in Surah Nisa, chapter 4, verse number 56, as to those who reject our signs, we shall cast them into the hellfire. And as often as the skins are roasted, we shall give them fresh skin so that they shall feel the pain. Quran says, as often as the skins are roasted, we shall give them fresh skin so that they shall feel the pain, indicating there is something in the skin which is responsible for the feeling of pain. When Prophet Rasul, when he was shown this verse of the Quran, he was shocked. Then how could this thing be mentioned in the Quran 14 years ago? So logically, today, if we have to punish anyone, you know, Hitler, history tells us, incinerated 6 million Jews. If we have to give punishment and if we burn him, if we give punishment and burn him once, what about the balance 5,999,999? What about them? So if Almighty God wants in the hereafter, he can burn him 6 million times. He can do it 10 million times. As often as the skins are roasted, we shall give them fresh skin so that they feel the pain. This is justice. And Prophet Ghashan, after verifying the tashrih of the Quran and speaking with Prophet Kithmur, he was so impressed with the Quran that in the 9th medical conference in Riyadh in Saudi Arabia, in the conference he said the Shahada, La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah. My question to the atheist is, who could have mentioned all these things in the Quran? The only reply the atheist can give you, it is the creator. It is a producer, it is a manufacturer, it is an inventor. This creator, this producer, this manufacturer, this inventor, we Muslims, we call him as Allah. So with the help of the Quran, we can scientifically prove that the Quran is the word of Almighty God, who is the creator of the universe of the human beings. I don't know of any other way today at present that we can prove the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the existence of God scientifically, besides with the help of the Quran. Without the Quran, without the help of the Quran, I cannot prove scientifically the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So I'm killing two birds with one stone. I have also proved scientifically that Quran is the God's word and also proved the existence of Almighty God Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you have heard about Albert Einstein, Albert Einstein was the person who got the Nobel Prize. And he said that science without religion is lame and religion without science is blind. Let me tell you that the glorious Quran is not a book of science, S-C-I-E-N-C-E, but it's a book of signs, S-I-G-N-S. It's a book of ayats. And there are more than 6,000 ayats, signs in the glorious Quran, out of which more than 1,000 speak about science. Someone will ask me that, Brother Zakir, are you taking the help of science to prove the Quran is God's word? I say no. I'm not taking the help of science because for me, Quran is my yardstick. Quran is far superior to science. I'm using the yardstick of the atheist, of the non-Muslim. That is science. I'm using their yardstick and comparing with my yardstick. Their yardstick, the science, I'm comparing with my yardstick, the Quran, and trying to prove that Quran is far superior. Yet there are many things mentioned in the Quran which science hasn't discovered. Maybe they'll discover tomorrow, after 50 years, after 100 years, after 1,000 years. But there is not a single verse in the Quran which has been proved to be wrong according to scientific fact. There is not a single verse. There may be scientific hypotheses and theories which go against the Quran, but we know many a time these theories and hypotheses take U-turn. I challenge anyone to point out a single verse of the Quran which is against established science. That's the reason. A very famous philosopher by the name of Francis Bacon, he said, little knowledge of science makes you an atheist, a disbeliever in God. But in-depth knowledge of science makes you a believer in God. That's the reason today science is not eliminating God, it is eliminating models of gods. La ilaha illallah. There is no God but Allah. I would like to end my speech with the quotation of the verse of the Quran which I started with, that from Surah Fussilat. chapter number 41, verse number 53, where it says, Sanurihim ayatina fil afaqi wa anfusihim hatta yatabayyana annahu al-haq. Soon we shall show them our signs in the furthest reaches of the horizons until it is clear to them that this is the truth. Allah takes it upon himself that to every human being he will show the signs of Almighty Allah. Whether Dr. Zakir Naik gives a lecture or not, it's not required. Allah takes it upon himself whether somebody teaches him or not. Allah takes it upon himself that he will show the signs of Almighty God into the hearts of every human being, into their souls, until he believes that this is the truth and no not. I would like to end my talk by saying, no God, no peace. No God, no peace. N-O, no God. N-O, no peace. K-N-O-W, no God. K-N-O-W, no peace. The best answer that any Muslim can give regarding the definition of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the definition of Almighty God, is quote Surah Ikhlas, chapter number 112, verse number 1 to 4, which says, Kul huwa Allahu ahad. Say, He is Allah one and only. Allah as-samad. Allah, the absolute eternal. Lam yalid wa lam yulad. He begets not, nor is he begotten. Walam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad. There's nothing like him.